Okay, folks, I'm getting the indication from our folks. We're live. Thank you. Okay. Welcome, everybody. Today it's Tuesday, May 24, 2016. This is a special meeting for our budget study session. Welcome. We're located at Moore Bay Veterans Hall. Meeting start is at 3:30, and the location is 209 Surf Street. For the record, all members of council are present. We do have a quorum, and we'll call the meeting to order. Thank you. And with that, for today, the topic is our budget study session, and unless there's any opening comments from council, I would turn it over to our city manager to make the introductions for the budget study session presentation. During that time, we can go through questions and answers during the presentation, and at the conclusion, of course, we can go through some questions, and following the questions from council, we'll open up for public comment, bring it back to council for discussion and direction. And with that, are there any opening comments or discussion from council? Seeing none? Okay, great. We'll turn it right over to our city manager, Mr. Buckingham, and get started.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Welcome, everybody. So the purpose of this session is to provide the council and our residents an initial opportunity to provide input to the draft FY16-17 budget. That is the budget that begins on the 1st of July of this year and goes to the 30th June of next year. And actually, that probably should not say an initial opportunity because actually there's been significant opportunity to inform this budget since the beginning of the year. So in February of 2016, the council established the city's FY16-17 budget objectives through our goals and objectives, our strategic framework process, and there was significant public input and staff input to that. And then in March, a month later, we hosted a 10-year budget forecast study session that that all of you and many of our residents attended. And then during the month of April, staff developed this draft budget, taking informed by the FY16-17 budget objectives, informed by staff expert assessment on things that need to be done, informed by council input through the year, notes we've been taking, and from residents. And so that brings us to where we are now, May 24th, on budget study session number one. This is slightly different than last year, I think in a good way. Last year we had a very lengthy initial budget study session one evening. That was a great time. We actually got all the way through it, and we're pretty much complete with the budget by the end of that. We're going to have two bites at the apple this time. So the mayor and I spoke this morning, and I'll try to do a little bit of a quicker overview today. Get input, and then next Tuesday night we'll have budget study session number two, at which we can make final changes and modifications based on the council's direction, and then that'll be May the 31st and then June the 14th. Hopefully you'll adopt the budget in a regular council meeting, and if we still have issues or concerns, we can push that off and adopt it on the 28th and still have it adopted before the beginning of the fiscal year. So with that sort of opening, I'll sort of plow on through this, except what I'll do is I'll stop a number of points after each sort of section and see if there's any council questions, so we don't let too many questions pile up. But I think the hope here is to get through most of the presentation so that there's still time afterwards to allow for public comment, council questions, and council discussion. So there's three sort of basic areas of this overview. First, an overview of a number of items: our budget forecast, some staff organization, salary schedule, and MOU negotiations update, and then into the base budget, the FY16 base budget, and then perhaps a discussion and prioritization of some unfunded requirements. So let's get on with the overview of the 10-year forecast, and of course the staff is here when we get to any questions to help me answer questions. You saw this, this is a few slides from the 10-year budget forecast that you saw in March. The forecast, I guess, basically shows that the city can continue to maintain stable finances. We have stable finances. We're not running a deficit, but those stable finances are at current service levels, which are perhaps not the appropriate service levels for a full-service city. So we're not about to sink, but nor are we providing all the services that we think we should be providing as a city, and I'll identify a few of those in a couple of minutes. Our forecast projects a mild 5% recession in 2018. Last year, we were projecting it for 17. This year, for 18, since it doesn't appear to be coming quite yet. And maybe it won't come at all, but the important thing is we're actually forecasting that in case it happens. It does project actually a 2.25% employee COLA. The CPI, the Consumer Price Index, over the last 3 months, the average has been 2.4%. We'll go into this. So included in this budget is up to a 2.25% COLA for our employees for this year. That's a cost of living adjustment to essentially keep them up with inflation. And it does consider a short-term spike in pension costs, which we'll talk momentarily. Here are the major sources of revenue. It's important just holistically to remember and to take a look at this. Our property tax is the major source. That's in blue there, about almost 30%. That's our major source of revenue. That's also a fairly stable source of revenue for us. Even during bad times, our property tax did not take the kind of dive that other California cities did. TOT, important to note here, that's in green at the bottom. TOT is 25% of our city's general fund revenues. We live or die by tourism. You'll see a chart in a second that shows what our where the expenses are in this budget. The police department is roughly 25% of this budget. So it's important for us to recognize that that right now we are living or dying by tourism. Hopefully, as we're able to expand our economic base and become a bit more diverse, the importance of that will always be important, I think, but we'll have some resilience. Sales tax is weak compared to TOT, and property tax, and I mean that in a strategic, holistic basis. It's not weak this year, but compared to other cities, most other cities have that flip-flop. They have some big box stores, they have strong sales tax, and they're less reliant on TOT. We're the other way around. Our TOT is roughly twice what our sales tax is. Speaking of taxes, it's important that we hear lots of questions of, hey, where did all those taxes go? What are you doing with all those taxes? So just a quick review. When it comes to federal income tax, none of that comes directly to the city. Same with state income tax. So all the state income tax that folks pay, none of that comes directly back to the city. Our property tax, so the property tax paid by Morro Bay residents, over 90% of property tax goes to the county and schools and other county and sort of regional requirements. Less than 10% of our residents' property tax come to the city of Morro Bay. Sales tax, 82% of the sales tax that's paid in the city goes to the state. 12% of it comes to the city general fund budget, and 6% of it comes to the city under Measure Q for streets and for public safety. Important to note, and we would love to get the firm figures on this, and we're working to do that, but it is likely that about 50% of the sales tax in Morro Bay is actually paid by visitors and non-residents. The number of visitors that we have here again, I'd like to do the science on this, but our assessment is likely fully half of the sales tax is actually paid by residents. So you could almost talk about that as another source of visitor funds, not resident funds. And finally, transient occupancy tax, 100% of transient occupancy tax comes to the city. So that is the area that is has the most direct return on investment, so to speak, for the city. Continuing with the budget forecast, the city's contribution to PERS is beginning its known spike. That word is sort of stinging, but the good news is that for Morro Bay, that spike will draw down fairly quickly back to the current level after about 4 years. I think the entire state of California is still recovering from largesse in pensions 10, 15 years ago, and this is part of the result of that. What's important for the city of Morro Bay is where you see those red dotted and the blue lines going up. For many, many cities, in fact, most in California, they stay at that raised rate for about a decade before they start to drop off. So we've got, and we worked through this with you last year, and we adjusted our general fund emergency reserve level slightly to account for this. But it's important to recognize that now we're in that period. And the good news is now that we're in it, we should be out of it in 4 to 5 years. So I also note that the city is taking action to reduce the cost of pensions. Tier one employee retirements have a fairly significant softening effect on the city's pension requirements. Here's our revenue against expenses forecast. Our revenue is projected to increase generally in line with expenses. From a stable budget perspective, that's good. From a are we providing the services that we need to perspective, maybe not. That maybe that's not such good news. So what we really need is for our revenues to increase above expenses so that we can pave our streets, so that we can put the have the additional revenue that we believe we need for the services that we believe our residents expect. It's important to note here that in FY 18, 19, and 20, the expenses are slightly over revenues. And that is the effect of both that pension spike that I described and the potential and our forecasting of a recession in 2018. But then you see by 2021 expenses come back in line with revenues, and the shaded green line is a 5% above or below it's 2% above or below tolerance, I believe. So if revenues are a little bit better or a little bit worse than we forecast, you can see how that affects. Here's the $3 million budget gap that I've noted a number of times already this evening and have noted many times in the last year in various venues from council meetings and budget forecasts to Bay News articles. What you see in red there is our nearly $13 million general fund, but that piece of blue pie that's missing, that is about $3 million of requirements that we believe requirements for services that we believe we should be providing that we simply don't have the revenues to provide. So important to note again, we're not running a deficit. What we're doing is we're living within our means. But for example, our streets, we are going to commit $587,000 this year to our streets, almost $600,000. We likely require about $1.5 million a year for our streets, actually a little bit more to get them up to the right level. So to simply maintain our streets at the appropriate level, we need about $1.5 million a year. We've only got about $600,000. So there's nearly $1 million gap between our revenues and our requirements right there just in streets. There's another $1 million gap in facility replacement, funded depreciation, so to speak. So when City Hall falls down or Amy's Chief Christie's police station needs to be replaced, or more quickly likely the Harbor Office needs to be replaced, we in the past have not saved for that. We need to be saving about $1 million a year in order to be able to pay for those things when they come due, instead of get to that point and say, oh no, what are we going to do, and then borrow money against it. Probably another $250,000, both in police and fire. We'd love to get another two officers on the street. Our officers are extremely busy responding to immediate needs with less ability, less time to sort of do community policing, beat cop things, and check in on businesses and check in on people. They invite everybody to spend a day or a half a day with our, do a ride along with our police, fantastic folks, and you'll see them responding with little time to again do those sort of more community oriented policing things that we'd like them to do. Other services, one that falls in there is recreation programs. Our city values recreation, and there is likely more that we could be doing if we had the revenues to do it. Also note that with minimum wage nearly doubling from 2014 to 2020, $8 an hour in 2014 up to $15 an hour in 2021, we're going to have some difficulty continuing to provide recreation programs at our current level without pumping additional, at the current level, at current program costs, without putting additional general fund revenues in there. So that's one of the things that we would love to be able to continue to provide youth soccer at the same program cost. But with the cost of providing youth soccer likely nearly doubling, that's going to be hard to do without either A, raising the program fee, or B, committing additional general fund revenues to that program. With that, I'll take a brief pause and see if there's any questions on the budget forecast. I think you were able to ask Mr. Leyland most of your questions a month and a half ago, but if there's any that you want to ask now, that's great.
Any questions from council? No?
Yeah, I just want to follow up on that last comment there about recreation services, and a third track that I know the staff is looking into that you should probably be aware of from the public angle is the public-private partnership opportunities, and those are being researched as well, and I think that's an important third option that will help us, hopefully.
Absolutely. That's one of our objectives this year is to explore and work and partner with other organizations and agencies to provide a fuller program at a lower cost.
Okay,
the next thing I'd like to do is just forecast sort of or project forward a number of city staff organizational items. These are all included in the budget, but it's important to note them clearly. So these are the things that as your city manager I'm intending to do in order to make sure the staff is operating as effectively and efficiently as possible. So first up there on the top right, human resources will be moving out from under what was the administrative services department. The human resources will be working under the city clerk's office. And that brings us to the second one, which is the finance department. A year ago, we had an administrative services department that was responsible for finance and IT and HR. What we moved IT under the deputy city manager this time last year, and then are moving HR under the city clerk's office this year. And that will allow our finance department to focus squarely and completely on all things finance instead of it's been a challenge for Susan and for others to have sort of a split focus between all the areas of finance and thinking about HR and thinking about IT. We established the Community Development Department last year. We did not fully promote Mr. Graham to Community Development Director last year. He's been serving as a Community Development Manager last year. This budget makes him a Community Development Director. Which part of that was to ensure that the organizational change was how we need to operate, and it is absolutely how we need to operate. We've seen measurable improvements, really significant improvements in community development and building planning, permitting over the past year and really the past 2 years as Scott's been here. So that is included in the budget. Number of things in rec services. So this sort of formally identifies recreation services as a recreation services division. It also slightly increases one of our two positions there from a supervisor position to what is a higher coordinator position. So when the rec director departed last year, what we were left with was two recreation services supervisors who are co-equal, both of them reporting to one person, the deputy city manager. Now with one of them having recently departed, we've got the opportunity to hire one of those positions in a slightly higher position. I think it's about $3,000 a year difference on the budget. What that does, it gives us one leader over in recreation services, and that one coordinator will look holistically at the whole department and supervise the whole department and report to the deputy city manager. It also makes two recreation employees that have been working full-time for a number of years, but with partial benefits, as FTE employees. Really did that because I got guidance from the council when we talked about this with community development a month ago, month and a half ago, that you thought was important, and I agree that we treat people fairly and equally. If they're working full-time and they're in an enduring position, we ought to be treating them like the rest of our full-time employees. Next is a tourism division. The tourism division has now moved or is in the process of moving under economic development. We're about to hire, we've identified and are finalizing the hiring of a tourism manager. That was actually approved back in January. You approved that as part of the bringing tourism underneath the city, and just want to highlight that is a new really a division that's under economic development, and in fact we could add that as a new box there going forward. Field maintenance supervisor, this represents, I think, probably the end of a 6 or 7 year effort to truly consolidate maintenance. There was a time when we had parks maintenance in one place and streets maintenance in another place and facilities maintenance in another place. Each of them had a supervisor, had a lead worker. There were recommendations as long ago as the management partners study from 7 years ago that said, take all those folks and combine them into one department. Or one division. That was sort of done, but the lead workers still remained. What we've done now with some personnel transitions is we've abolished three of the lead worker positions. We have one field maintenance supervisor, that's Mr. Bishop, and he supervises that whole team of, I believe it's 15 maintenance folks, and they can surge, and all 15 can go work on streets, or all 15 can work on parks, or he can divide them up, and so it gives us flexibility. More importantly, it consolidates that, and we've actually have a little bit of savings from moving from three different lead workers to one supervisor position. I put an ACM up there with a question mark. We have a number of transitions going on in the next 4 months. Ms. Slayton, sitting behind me, has announced her retirement for the end of this year, and so we are in the midst of hiring for a finance director, and we're planning for an overlap between Susan and that incoming finance director. Also, as you know, Mr. Taylor is sadly leaving to sad that Susan's leaving too. Sorry, Mr. Taylor is sadly leaving to go to his hometown, where his mother is very sick, and where he grew up, to take a position there. And so really hiring two key positions, and as we go through that, I'd like the flexibility to, based on the quality of the candidates, we're not exactly sure what different skill sets different candidates will have. It could be that we come back to you and let you know that actually the future deputy city manager has huge skills in HR, and it makes more sense to put HR there. But what this projects is a little bit of flexibility to potentially hire either the finance director or the deputy city manager position as an assistant city manager. Important to note, that is not an assistant to, that's not a flunky that just hangs out and takes orders from me. That is, first they would have the entire portfolio that the deputy city manager has there: economic development, public information, IT, and supervising recreation. But it may be that either that person or the new finance director has the skills and capacity to serve as an assistant city manager also, which really has a level of authority to help me administer the departments, the staff, especially in my absence. And so I'm going to be looking closely at that with those that help us on interview panels going forward. And finally, at the top there, that our FTE going forward this year is those couple of changes there, most of which were previously approved, set our FTE for this year at 96.75 across the entire enterprise, which includes the enterprise funds. Any questions on that?
Just one quick comment, and I'll turn it over for questions. First of all, I just wanted to say to Ms. Slayton, congratulations, and thank you for your service. And that, I just wanted to lead off with that. Thanks very much. And questions to my left, Christine?
Yes, good evening, everyone, and congratulations, Susan. You're out of here, but not quite yet. Just a question about the city staff organization. So just a procedural question. Do we need to affirm that we agree with this separately, and do we do that separate from the budget information, and do we do that tonight or wait till everything comes back? Just wondering guidance on that if we're shifting around things on the organization.
Great question. Thank you. And so two things. So in close consultation with our city attorney, what we determined is an appropriate way to do this. The municipal code is actually a little bit vague. It says that the city manager recommends changes to the organization. It does not necessarily say the city council approves those. What we thought it'd be wise to do is to include those in the budget, and along with approval of the budget, you would be approving, consenting to, affirming these recommended changes.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Great question. Thank you. Anybody else for comments or questions? Mr. Buckingham?
Wrong button. Okay, one quick slide on salary schedule and negotiation update. And mostly I just wanted you to everybody to see one sort of change we've made. So that in past years, the city has actually had 7 different salary schedules. There's been a salary schedule for police, for fire, for SEIU bargaining units, for management confidential, executive, and like most other cities, we'd like to copy things. We've said, why don't we go to one consolidated salary schedule? So this is a one page of our new 3-page salary schedule. We've taken all of the different employee groups and units, put them on one salary schedule, so it's easy for, it's very transparent. Folks can click right to it and see the all of the city's positions and what the salary schedule is for those. Two notes I'd make is that on this schedule, first, a number of the new positions are in bold, such as the tourism manager, the field services supervisor, and these are all in the budget letter that was produced last week. The other thing I'd note is that the police, most of our police folks are right now on a 6-step schedule. Everybody else is on a 5-step schedule, and it may be that that in the months or years ahead, we try to get the police onto a 5-step schedule so that everybody sort of has a matching schedule instead of one slight aberration. The I noted a few minutes ago that the average of the January, February, and March CPI for the LA region had an average increase of 2.4%. The city is currently offering, and in negotiations with the unions, with our bargaining units, a 2.25% COLA increase. And so this budget reflects that. It reflects a 2.25 increase, and anything greater than a 2.25% increase will take the budget into deficit. Questions on that, Mr. Mayor?
Any questions from council? Okay, thank you.
Okay, so we'll get on with the sort of the meat of the general fund budget and start going through staff sections. But first, two quick overview slides, maybe 3 overview slides. So first, the process that we used, the staff used our 15-16. Last year's budget as a base. We adjusted for some of the organizational changes I just described. We relied heavily on the 10-year budget forecast. This budget is nested with, modeled on that 10-year budget forecast. We retained essential spending that was really started last year for the first time, capital replacement, some IT spending, a consolidated vehicle replacement plan. We increased street spending by 10% in order to it's far shy of what it needs to be, but we were able to increase it 10% this year from last year. We included 2.5% COLA, or that should be 2.25, I'm sorry, COLA, as I just described. We cut some sustainment items and some lower priorities to achieve a balance in the budget, and we ended where we needed to be, which is with an $11,000 surplus right now. Probably worth to note that a little different from my family's budget, And most of our budgets, with a near $13 million general fund budget, things change as you go through the year, and so the having $11,000 surplus that should not necessarily be seen as great. Let's find a place to spend it, because there will be some expenses that we don't anticipate. There might be some savings we don't anticipate. Bottom line is we're presenting a budget that is nearly balanced. Nearly balanced on the positive side. So a quick overview, this budget directly funds 76 of the 88 objectives that you approved as part of our goals and objective setting process earlier this year. There are residual funds available for at least 9 of the unfunded objectives, and we'll go through that near the end of the budget. Street spending is up 13% from $520,000 to $587,000. There is a 50% increase in tree trimming last year. That was a priority for some of our residents and the council. This budget retains, it really confirms the threefold increase in weekend and afternoon hours bathroom cleaning and trash collection that we've done in two parts over some in the fall and then again in the spring to really keep up with demand. So that increase is now baked into the base budget. It funds the $100,000 zoning ordinance update that you as a council approved earlier this year, and we said we needed to budget for, and it is in here. It adds a part-time training coordinator to the police department. That's a non-sworn training coordinator that will allow our sworn officers to be out on the street more. Again, this is sort of a theme that I've described here, but take some of the training planning off of sworn officers onto a part-time non-sworn so that our officers can spend more time on the streets. That's just a brief overview. We'll get into some department-by-department details. Here's the obligatory pie chart. Make sure you get a good feel for it because this is the only pie chart in the budget. The rest of the pie charts were replaced with cool pictures this year. So what you see, the sort of starting from the bottom right, police department and fire department in blue and red, that they represent nearly 45% of our general fund. I should say this is the general fund and Measure Q put together. So this doesn't include harbor water or sewer or some of the other smaller funds. But what it does show, because a significant portion of our police and fire are funded through Measure Q, and because streets is such a priority, included Measure Q in this along with the general fund. So what you see in the pie are the general fund and Measure Q spendings, or you could say general fund plus streets. So police and fire represent about 45% of all that. Public Works Department is a big chunk. Then continuing up the left side, community development and recreation are side by side. They're both nearly $1 million each. Streets is near the 1130 position at nearly $600,000. You see a bunch of little slices in there. Those are those important little slices that we added last year, and we're working hard to protect and actually expand each year. That's our capital replacement fund, capital projects fund, vehicle replacement fund, and then continue around from the top. There's a little slice there for city council, and then the red one at 1 o'clock is sort of a consolidated administration. That's the city manager, the city clerk, risk management, and HR all together as one. In green is citywide contracts, and we'll get into that in a moment. There's a little tiny sliver there for economic development. That's and public information officer. That is about 50% of Mr. Taylor. The rest of Mr. Taylor is spread between IT and recreation. And then you see a blue slice for finance, and then an orange slice for IT. So that gives you a feel graphically of sort of where the general fund budget primarily goes. I think I'll continue pressing on through the staff sections here. So the city council section of the budget allocates the cost for you, our city council, for various essential memberships for the city, not for you, but for the city, our LAFCO membership, our League of California Cities membership, some, and then there's some discretionary spending. There is $8,000 for sort of benevolence giving for worthy causes like senior nutrition and SCORE, and we'll come to that near the end of the budget. It budgets funds for the entire new council to attend the new council member or new mayors and council members academy this January or February in Sacramento. So there are funds available for the whole council to do that based on whatever turnover there might be with the election. And you have an opportunity later on. There's $5,000 that could be committed from our housing in lieu, not from the general fund, important point, but from housing in lieu fund to fill a request from HomeShare SLO. Moving on to the city manager section, this section is just me and my share of utilities and telephone bills and insurance and those things. It includes some continued professional development training. And then in the goals-related spending, last year we identified $30,000 for an economic development opportunity fund, reduced that to $25,000 this year. Then there's $3,000 for staff training events to keep our staff trained as a team, and then $1,000 for one or more advisory board volunteer recognition events like we did last December, and we hope to do with approval again this December to recognize our advisory boards. This is a new section of the budget. This is the major citywide contracts. These are citywide contracts. Contracts that serve most or all of the departments, different from a contract in public works that's for street sweeping, for example. These things used to be split up across all of the departments, and we found that putting them all together helps us to sort of be more transparent and better understand how much it costs to provide some of these services and where these services go. So it includes $7,500 for PARS. That's our public PARS.
Public agency retirement system.
That's it. That's essentially the equivalent for that we have to do for Social Security for part-time employees. That's the fee for being part of that. This has the general fund portion of our legal contract, $150,000. $60,000 is our contract with AGP Video in order to televise this meeting and all the other meetings that they do a great job doing. Both the sheriff's contract for dispatch and the CAL FIRE dispatch contract are consolidated here. That's a hefty $375,000, but our assessment is that has been a good move made, I think, almost 2 years ago now, it has not been a cost loss, and the service is very good. A couple of other smaller things there, digital map and DocuTeam, $35,000 for all the copying required in the city, the $50,000 visitor center contract that is currently with the Chamber of Commerce, and then finally, Animal Services deserves a quick phrase or two. So the Animal Services contract is up nearly $35,000 from last year. It was $45,000 last year. We're projecting or we're forecasting for $70,000 this year. The County Board of Supervisors has decided to build a new Animal Services
building.
Center building. I forget what the word is for one of those things. Shelter, that's it, animal shelter. Thank you. And so the board has decided to build a new animal shelter. We really have, essentially we contract with the county for animal services. So, and we pay for it based on how much we use it. So the number of lost pets that they come and pick up in Morro Bay, they count that and then essentially bill us a pro rata share compared to the rest of the cities in the county that use the service and the county itself. So what we're anticipating is a sizable increase in the cost of this contract because of the new construction of the facility. And I'll tell you that the seven city managers, we meet monthly and we talk about this one every month. We have two city managers who are sitting on with the county essentially and to ensure that we get a nice C-plus animal shelter and not an A-plus gold-plated animal shelter. So that's it. There's two city managers. They're sitting on part of that board to make sure that that the county plays fair with us and we get what we need and not not what one person up there thinks that they want to have. The city clerk's office, this includes the clerk, the deputy city clerk, and our HR analyst. It includes utilities and insurance and those things. It includes the completion of Dana's training to become a certified city clerk, which is not only a personal goal for her, but a professional goal for the city to have a fully certified city clerk. The includes $10,000 for the 2016 election. That'll be added to $10,000 from last year to pay the $20,000 bill for the election. A couple of contracts to continue with HR, risk management, and clerk training. LCW, Liebert, Cassidy, and Whitmore is actually a law firm that does a lot of training that we access webinars to keep folks up with current HR law, especially to make sure we don't get in trouble. And this includes $2,500 toward record management, which is part of Goal 10C, or is Goal 10. This is the first little step to getting, hopefully, a much improved record management system in the city. The deputy city manager, perhaps assistant city manager, budget. That's actually it's less than one person because part of this, part of that person, as I said before, is taxed out to IT and part to rec. All the sort of normal things in there. The discretionary spending. There is $3,000 to continue what we believe is an improved public communication effort. Water bill mailers, other mailers that we've used in order to and printing of. Perhaps Bay News articles that we have at our service desk to keep our public information up. I already spoke about the potential assistant city manager, that should be CM, not MC, opportunity. I won't go into any more detail on that. Staff section budgets continued. This is finance, so this budget section is for our future finance department without IT and HR included. Our finance director, senior accounting tech, several account clerks has. There are a number of expensive things in here, such as the annual audit, licensing for our financial software, and there's a little bit of discretionary spending. We've identified $5,000 from under finance for the 10-year budget forecast this coming February, and we'll also be continuing on with doing a harbor 10-year forecast and then add a water and sewer 10-year forecast. Those will come out of those enterprise funds. The police department budget includes all of the current sworn personnel and support personnel. I mentioned earlier that it includes one part-time training manager. The number in the base budget does not include $90,000 from Measure Q for the police department for a number of items. We're actually, Chief Christie did a great job and realized that as we were down to budget cutting time, found $15,000 and reduced fuel costs from last year. So we had budgeted one thing last year and didn't spend it. So hopefully fuel costs will stay about where they are. And I already talked about the training coordinator. Oh, good. Fire department. No significant changes in staffing. I do note down here that we're increasing the admin person's time from 20 hours to 30 hours. That is really in order to free up some time for Steve to focus on grants. So fire is one place where we can make a lot of money in grants, and so. Actually think that will pay off because giving Steve the opportunity to write for some big dollar item grants will likely easily pay for that $10 or that 10-hour increase in time. This does not include $340,000 from Measure Q. We'll get into the details of Measure Q in a few minutes. It does change, so you'll notice a difference from last year in budgeting for mutual aid. So in past years, we have budgeted for mutual aid. So mutual aid is when the fire department is called out in the summer to go fight a forest fire in Stanislaus County. As they go out, it increased our costs because we're paying those firefighters to go do that, but then we're reimbursed for that. And we're actually always reimbursed with an administrative fee. So we actually sort of make some money on mutual aid. In previous years, we budgeted for mutual aid. We sort of tried to guess about how much it might be, and that's, one, hard to do because you don't know how many fires there are going to be, and two, it tends to skew our revenue projections a little bit, so we don't want to become reliant on mutual aid, so to speak. And so what we've done this year is taken those guesses out, because we know that if the fire department is called out for mutual aid, they will be reimbursed for more than the expenses that mutual aid costs. So that's you'll see a slight change in numbers from last year, and that's primarily where that is. Public Works, no major changes in FTE on personnel. I already spoke that the Consolidated Maintenance Division is now truly consolidated. This includes our engineering, our maintenance, storm drains, streets, street lighting. There are a bunch of different areas of this budget, of the public works budget, and it can be a little bit confusing because people are sort of charged out all over the place. Damaris, is charged to three or four different areas of the budget, but each one of those has to be there because of some state requirements to specifically do storm drains separately or street lighting separately. So it can be a little bit confusing down in there. This included in this part of the budget is, or not included, is the $587,000 for streets that is out of Measure Q. It's important to note that is for street rehabilitation, street repair, and street paving. Included in the budget is street, let's call it minor repair, and that is potholes and that sort of thing. And so, in fact, included in the budget is 5 tons of asphalt a week for 8 months. That's in the base budget, $20,000 to replace 20% of our non-conforming regulatory signs. Each of these things is associated with one of the goals that you approved. Our street sweeping contract, which is a state requirement. I mentioned already the increase for tree trimming and the increase in the weekend and after-hours bathroom cleaning.
Mr. Buckingham? Maybe just pause for a question. I want to catch up on one question, but look to council, see if there's any questions to where we're at now. Seeing none, just want to follow up on one question on page 10, slide 20. I know I'm catching up a little bit, but on staff sections, budgets, and the discretionary spending, the $5,000 for home share, slow housing in lieu, is that to presume that it is effective for Morro Bay? Is that a program that's going to be within Morro Bay, or is that going to a San Luis Obispo like county type of program? Those are in lieu funds from the city, so I just wanted to ask that question.
That's to the county home share. They do provide some services in Morro Bay.
Okay. Just want to make sure. Thank you. Any other questions?
Mr. Arns, I just want to let you know that representative from the program's here and will present a public comment.
Good. Thanks. Thank you.
Okay, couple more on the general staff budgets. So community development, there's no increase to the previously approved personnel levels in this in the budget. Has includes all of the sort of the normal things for utilities and insurance and supplies. The discretionary spending that is included in here, I already mentioned the $100,000 for the zoning ordinance update associated with, or which is goal 3B. There's $15,000 for environmental consultant services related to two other specific goals. $15,000 for City Works hosting services. That's really a continuation from fiscal year 15-16, and I likely won't highlight that next year because that'll be one of those normal recurring things as we get City Works fully up and operational. Didn't know we had two public works departments. That's great. There's only one public works department, $2.3 million worth. 2.33 actually. The Recreation Department is, so the personnel here includes four full-time personnel, including one coordinator. I described that coordinator adjustment or a change earlier on in organization. I also mentioned the change of two of our previously full-time partial benefits employees to FTE. And it's important to note, I think the council's probably tracking this, but for anybody that's listening to this and wasn't listening to the previous discussion, with changes in the Affordable Care Act and changes in PARS, the cost difference in the benefits that we must provide to a part-time employee and the benefits that we provide to a full-time employee, the difference in that has shrunk measurably over the last 10 years or whatever it is. So the I believe it's about $8,000 difference in total in the benefits for an employee, whereas that used to be much more significant. Some goal spending. This budget does include $16,000 for two recreation guides. Depending on how well we do with selling ads in those recreation guides, this might fund all three of them. And if we do really well selling ads, we won't spend all of this or perhaps not any of it. So what this is a first time we've done this. It's a best guess on what will be required to publish two separate recreation guides this coming year. In the budget is $5,000 for a total of $7,500 for two of our city council approved city sponsored events, one being the 4th of July, which is all on the city, and then the other being the downtown Halloween parade and celebration, which is partnered with the Chamber of Commerce. Okay, I'm going to take a pause there and see if there's any questions on the staff
go ahead, Matt.
Sections before we get to some of the special revenue funds.
Dave, I do have a question on, on page number 9, slide 18. We're talking about increasing street spending 13%, $520,000 to $587,000. Does that mean that's the single year street spending, or is that the 2 year savings that we were talking about?
Great question.
About?
That is this year. So that will be added to the streets money that was allocated last fiscal year but not obligated and spent. And so those two will be put together, and then we'll start executing and doing that work hopefully in August or September.
Yeah, yes. Just briefly, I don't know if you had a chance to follow up on this question from when we talked earlier. It's not very important, but it is something I think that may come up is with the street lighting on page 28 of the budget document and the LED, recent installation of LED lights. Looks like we're tracking to spend a little more on street lighting this year, and I guess I think everyone was assuming we'd see that start to drop with the additional LED lighting. So whether now or later, it'd be interesting to see a little more detail on that.
Rob?
Just briefly, the city contracts with PG&E for the street lighting, and they did not adjust the tariff rate for street lighting with the LEDs because they need to pay for that capital project. So there really is no cost savings as of yet. That cost savings will be benefited in outer years.
Okay, so we actually do get to see the cost, the true electrical costs billed to us, and eventually we'll see those savings.
They don't meter those lights, so there is no electrical cost. It's a flat rate per light. So it's based on what the PUC allows them to bill for that tariff for that street light.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, pressing on with, we're doing pretty well on time actually. Six or seven slides left, I think. So pressing on with some of the special revenue funds, enterprise funds. Information technology is now an internal service fund. We did that last year, so here's where you see all of the IT costs and requirements. This includes part of Mr. Taylor and all of Mr. Doerr's time. It includes a share of utility and insurance, those things, payment for expire for IT contracts and programs, the licenses on our various software items of software, and a number, couple of pieces of goal-related spending. There's $10,000 allocated to move the servers out of City Hall, sort of the rat trap back there between Steve and Susan and the other closet. What we intend to do, it's not just to get rid of the rat trap, but it's for resilience. So there's no backup power in City Hall. We'll move the servers to the fire station, and then that will give us backup power, put the servers in the same place that our EOC is, and then perhaps we can clean out that area and make a little better use of it in City Hall. So the there are $40,000 for IT support services as part of our ongoing transformation and how we deliver IT services. Many places really provide IT with a twofold way, depending on how big they are, a full-time person or even a part-time person, and then some contracted services that are often off-site. So much of our IT work can be done through the web off-site, and somebody can get right into your computer and move the mouse around and fix things. This will give us the opportunity to do that. Perhaps more important is we are finishing right now our life cycle replacement program for IT. So in previous years, when your computer broke or when you wanted a new computer, you argued for money and got a new computer. We're writing a life cycle replacement plan that says, and then when you got a new computer, you got sort of whatever you wanted. We're taking all that away from the departments. They're very happy about that. But it is a good thing to have a life cycle replacement plan that says the normal life cycle of everybody's computer is 4 years, and here is the replacement that we're going to buy, and then we can buy them in bulk and as packages in order to keep our machines up to date, but also get the sort of the power of bulk buying. Measure Q, Measure Q revenues are projected at just over $1 million this year. You see the allocation there. I've mentioned streets several times, and we've able to increase that again 13% this year. So on the pie chart, the purple part is how much of that $1 million is going to streets. The green part is fire, and the red part is police. The primary things in there are the reserve or the extra firefighter, the fourth firefighter, really, that was added a number of years ago during as Measure Q was passed, and then the dead on the fire station. And the police is the city's portion of the school resource officers. There's one or two smaller equipment items, some personal protective equipment for fire, and I believe our payment for to the Sheriff's Department for our bomb squad coverage and another piece of and the SWAT coverage. The Tourism Bureau, this is that special revenue fund is included in the budget. A couple important things to note. This is just, as most are aware, this is the 3% assessment on hotel and motel stays that fund our tourism marketing and promotion. What is in the budget matches the TBID board approved budget exactly. What the board proposed and was presented to you actually as part of their annual report a few weeks ago, that's exactly what is in here. It includes the $60,000 general fund contribution that you approved in January to establish a citywide stake and interest in tourism marketing and promotion. There are three employees in that department. I mentioned that we are in the midst of hiring the one FTE employee. There is one contract employee and then one part-time employee. And those are the same folks. They're the same number as was in the Morro Bay Tourism Bureau. The main expense in this is the PR, is the marketing contract with Mental Marketing, and the PR contract that's included with Mental. Those contracts were approved by the council already. And then it includes, not an additional, but in all of that, about $50,000 to support events here in Morro Bay, which many of our our visitor-supporting businesses are excited that the city is contributing or is helping with keeping events going, because they do have a significant effect on our the number of visitors that come, and on sales tax and on TOT. The Harbor Enterprise Fund is balanced. It is no significant changes in the Harbor Department this year. A number of things I'll note. So it does include $55,000 for a Marine Services Facility feasibility study, which is on our goals this year. So that money is allocated. The $25,000 for the fish cleaning station is, we still have that. That was actually budgeted last year. It's not been spent on something else, and that's ready to go in the fish cleaning station once we figure out if there's going to be some grant funding to help us do the whole project. The Harbor Fund, Eric, in his graciousness, is sharing part of the cost of the increased bathroom cleaning on the down on the waterfront, Morrow at the Rock and at Coleman. And then we're just starting. This isn't a big budget item, but excited to announce we're just starting the accounting for our new coin-operated showers at the Rock, so you can take a nice cold shower after you're done surfing. Make sure you bring some quarters. And so we've forecasted $3,000 of revenue and $3,000 expenses in water and repair when people might damage them. Significant amount of grant funding that Eric is also working is identified in here, but we're not relying on it. Water and sewer funds. Quick overview: the water and sewer rates that the community passed in 2015 have righted these previously underwater funds. The funds are producing sufficient revenue over expenses to fund the anticipated debt service for phase one of the water reclamation facility. So it's not fully up to the level it needs to be yet, but it will be as rates increase over the next 4 years. The staff is budgeted to include these two funds in our 10-year budget forecast, which has not been done before. So this is really a good news story, and that we did the water and sewer rate study last year, and then now we'll be starting to do a 10-year forecast on these funds to make sure that we don't get in the situation that we were in previously, where we had a significant unrealized deficit because we were deferring nearly $1 million a year of maintenance. Little bit, just one note on the water funds. That was an overview for both these funds. On the water fund itself, the utility discount is continuing. There's about 120 financially challenged residents who have signed up for the discount program. They receive about a 10% discount on their bill, so that's a good thing, and that's included in the budget here. And no changes really in the sewer fund for the current. For the current fund, obviously everybody's doing a lot of work on the future reclamation facility. Here's a summary of some other key funds and what their status is. This is all in the budget, but I wanted to pull it out and just highlight a couple of these things so it was can all be seen in one place. The general fund emergency reserve balance is currently $3.59 million. That will change slightly, go up about $20,000 this year, and we'll end the year at $3.6 million in the general fund emergency reserve, and that's about $300,000 above the council directed level for this coming year, but is still right at the 27.5% target level. So we don't see that $300,000 as a ripe for harvesting and spending on some of our unfunded requirements right now. The risk management fund is currently about $153,000. It'll increase by about $100,000 this year. So right now we're projecting a balance of $254,000 at the end of this coming year. Your council directed minimum balance in this fund is $100,000. So there may be some opportunity for some measured spending out of this fund this year, but there are a couple of requirements that could impact this fund, some potential litigation, some and another requirement. So I want to be careful about going after that possible $154,000 now until we're have better resolution or better fidelity on what those requirements against this fund could be. The capital replacement fund, so we started last year saving or put $100,000 against it last year. We're able to do $100,000 against it again this year. This is the fund that really should be about $1 million contribution a year in order to replace our do major facility replacement. The vehicle replacement reserve is currently at just over $100,000. There'll be a net $75,000. Actually, there's a $75,000. That's actually a misprint. I'm sorry. There is a $75,000 contribution to it this year. That's what that shows. But we're also projecting a $70,000 expense. So the balance is correct, but in the second column where it says $75,000, that the change is only going to be $5,000 from this year to next year, because there are two. We project we're likely going to have to replace two maintenance vehicles this year that are aging. The capital projects accumulation fund is $134,000 in there now. We're contributing another $125,000 to that this year. That is essentially for new capital projects. So that is a place that we could go in the future for new projects or for partial funding of new projects, such as a 41 and Main intersection, or a new public bathroom if we needed one, or a Embarcadero sidewalk widening. So that's the purpose of that fund, is to build up funds. It's also a great place to match grants, for example, 41 and Main, where we'll need a significant amount of matching funds. The facility maintenance fund is currently at $63,000. It's going to we've got, I believe, $108,000 going into it this year, but we're spending more than that on maintenance this year. This is our general maintenance fund. This is to repair plumbing around the city and lighting fixtures and leaks in roof and those sort of general maintenance things. The general plan fund has $417,000 in it. We're not. We're actually probably going to have to start paying some bills to Michael Baker International this year. And so we'll have to adjust this. There will actually be a change in FY16-17, a negative on there as we start to pay out of that fund for the general plan that we're in the middle of. Government impact fees. The government impact fees is currently at almost $500,000. There will likely be about $225,000 going into it this year. So right now we're projecting government impact fees could be over $600,000 by the end of this coming year. That is you'll see in a minute, that is one source of funds for some of our unfunded requirements that we'll propose here in a few minutes. Also, it is we want to be careful though about going too hard against that, because the 41 and Main project could be coming up this year, and especially if there's no street tax that passes, we're going to be needing almost $2 million in matching funds for that project. And finally, the compensable leaves fund. We sort of established that this last year with no money in it, and this is we essentially have an unfunded liability for the leave balances built up by employees that were every employee to retire today, it would be about a $600,000 cost. We established that last year and said this year we want to try to start putting money into it, and we were able to put $66,000 into it this year, and we're going to continue to do that and right size it so that we are at least putting in as much as comes out of it every year. What happens right now is if we have an unprojected retirement and somebody has $12,000 of compensable leaves that need to be paid. Then we look around the budget for $12,000 that we didn't project as an expense. So this is where we would be able to go to pay for those.
Mr. Buckingham?
Any questions on these last couple of funds here? Yes, sir.
Good, thanks. Any questions to my left or to my right?
I do have
Matt?
Dave, I do have a question about the general fund emergency reserve. I know you've talked a lot in the past year and a half or so talking about that 27.5. Is there a reason that we're a little bit higher and why you want to keep that in there? We went for a year, the current balance is 3.5 million, and the projected balance you're looking to, with the change this year, that 20,000, that will be 27.5, or is that?
3.6 will be just below 27.5% of our measurement for this year based on this year's revenues, because of course revenues have gone up slightly as well. And so the requirement that you have, the target that you have, is 27.5% of 3-year trailing revenues. The reason that it's a little bit healthier this year than we anticipated is because we have not seen the effects of recession yet. And so because that's hanging out there, we recommend that we just let it sit like it is right now. And also the other key thing is, we're not at the end of our fiscal year yet. And so we can't be sure how we're going to end this fiscal year. We still have a month of bills to come in, and a month of revenues to see. And so until we know how we've ended this fiscal year, we want to be careful with what we do with the general fund emergency reserve level.
Got it. And then I think last year you went over the 10-year budget forecast in terms of keeping that up. Some years we will be running higher than the 27.5 just to account for the downturns and
exactly
the fluctuations.
Right.
Got it. Thank you.
Yeah, it's higher this year because we're going to have the continued pension requirement next year and perhaps a recession. Thank you.
Any more to Noah?
Yes, thank you. This is going to be regarding the State Park Marina Special Revenue Fund on page 104, and Dave and I talked briefly about this earlier, but I did want to bring it up because there has been a fair amount of discussion regarding the future of the marina and the dredging project and opportunities about taking or looking at the expiration of the contract there for the marina and considering alternatives to help try to consolidate revenues to the fund and improve our opportunity to sustainably manage the marina. So I don't really want to get into a lot of detail on that, but it would be interesting to hear a brief update about how far out that contract is and whether or not that's going to be a discussion that could affect this year's projected budget there and how we're going to perhaps crack that.
Eric.
Sure, I'll take a shot at that, Councilman Smuckler. So, as you know, last year we entered into discussions with State Parks about RFPing both the marina and the cafe. Showed a preference for City of Morro Bay taking over the cafe concession. Parks turned us down on that. We're still trying to re-engage them and see what the possibilities of that moving in the future are. With the dredge possibility coming up here through the Corps of Engineers, they got extra funding to do the rest of our harbor channel this year. With that came the possibility of us piggybacking on with the Corps project, substantially reducing cost if we can get that dredge material disposal still in the nearshore, which is a regulatory challenge we're currently working on. So we're working on that at the same time of re-engaging parks, trying to wrap it all up in a package and bring it back to State Parks with, hey, here's what we think we need to do to make this work, and then amend the operating agreement if it looks like we continue to move forward and seeing where they want to go with the cafe concession as well.
Glad you're working forward on that.
And I have one question. I want to follow up on a question on page 19, slide 38, as far as the utility discount program. Great that we're seeing participation in that. I just want to ensure, how are we continuing the outreach? Is there, are we doing this biannually? Just want to make sure that, this is fairly new, that we keep engaged and we're measuring the participation on that, because it's a great number, but want to make sure that we're continuing the outreach. So is there any can you respond to that a little bit?
We just need to do continuous outreach on that. We'll include that in our utility bill mailers and some of our other outreach. Encourage you, council members to do that as well, and everybody else in the city. So I think we have about 120 people enrolled and perhaps 900 that would be eligible. So there are a significant number of folks who would be eligible and that have not. Is that number right, Susan? I get that right? Yeah. So there's a significant number of folks that that have either chosen not or not or not heard about it. So great question.
Okay, great. All right, thanks.
Okay, last two pieces to work on here. One is the council benevolence. I talked about this briefly as we started. So what you see here is last year's contribution amount to various agencies, and then a recommendation for this year. Essentially, the staff's recommendation is exactly what you did last year, but we did increase it from $7,500 last year to $8,000 this year. So there's a $500 TBD that could be sort of kept in reserve or allocated to somebody. And then at the bottom, you see the discussion about home share slow that we already discussed, that you could consider approving allocating $5,000 from our housing in lieu to home share slow. Probably want to come back to this one, but I'll just briefly do the last slide, and then we can maybe do both of these, mindful of time here. So the this is a list of the unfunded requirements or unfunded objectives. So as I stated at the beginning, I forget what I said, 77 of 88, I believe, of our objectives for this year are actually funded already in the budget. These are the few that are not. So what this shows down in the funding status line is UFR, that's an unfunded requirement. And then there's various sources of funds. GIF is government impact fees, and so I described a minute ago that we have likely over $600,000 of government impact fees that could be available, and those could be allocated to those first six requirements there. Then the seventh requirement in a slightly lighter or wider line is bike needs. That could be achieved with our LTF bike funds. The next one is economic development strategic plan implementation. We won't get the economic development strategic plan back until after we've likely approved the budget, late June, early July, and aren't sure exactly what implementation things will be in there and how much they'll cost. But guess maybe there's $50,000 worth of implementation that will come out of that. I initially put down here that perhaps we could go to the risk management fund. I described that we might have $150,000 of excess in that, but we wanted to be careful about that. But so that's sort of the fund I've got my eye on for economic development strategic plan implementation. And then the last three down there are other items, two that are budget transparency is not, it's a $15,000 item, but then the potential Embarcadero sidewalk widening could be $500,000 or more, and likely we're going to work on grants and a bunch of other things for that. But and really have not identified a source of funds for those. What I recommend we do is you have a discussion on those. You might want to prioritize these a little bit within their bands. So there's certain things that you can't use government impact fees for. But if we prioritize those, and then as we go through the budget session next week and then the approval of the budget, you might actually give the staff the authority to execute a few of these out of those funds and to keep a few sort of on the back burner, see how things are going, and then we could come to you during after a month or two into the year or at mid-year and say, hey, based on how things are going in the risk management fund and what we have for the economic development strategic plan implementation, here's how we recommend executing that.
Okay.
And that's it.
Okay, great report. Appreciate that. Any more questions from council at this point? Seeing none to my right. Any to my left? John? Let's get into questions here. And then once we conclude questions, then we'll open up for public comment. And then we'll come back for discussion.
I just wanted to make a quick point that I do have questions, and they're probably wrapped up into some comments as well. But I don't want to be mindful of the public, so mm-hmm. I'm willing to hold on and hear what the public has to say, and then maybe that would encourage different kinds of questions.
Okay.
So just wondering
anybody
if you
else?
Would get consensus on that?
That's great.
Okay.
I'm good with that. Thanks for that. I appreciate the input on that. And then, so in light of that, we have one speaker slip for public comment. Ann Wyatt, and is there anybody else in the audience that would like to speak to public comment? I only have one speaker slip. Seeing none, that'll conclude. Do you need to no? Okay. I'm sorry. Speaker slips are in the back, but I'll just open up for public comment. Yep, thanks. Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor Irons and council members. I'm Ann Wyatt. I'm program coordinator for Home Share SLO. Thank you for the opportunity to join you here this evening. And thank you to Mr. Buckingham for the thorough description of the budget and keeping us alive through exciting topics like compensable leaves funds. Yeah, thank you. That takes some explanation. I just wanted to make a couple brief comments. I know you have plenty to do here tonight. So just a few notes. I first of all wanted to respond to Mayor Irons' questions about portion of the budget. So what we have asked for from your council is $5,000 from your Affordable Housing in Lieu Fund. And we, HomeShare SLO, is looking to be a countywide operation. The sort of logical scale for our operation is the county. But we're starting this first year's operation with a targeted smaller scale approach along the North Coast. So we've designed that operational area as Los Osos to San Simeon. So we would more or less be serving four kind of communities, most of them unincorporated county communities. And our first year budget is looking to be about $40,000. So the $5,000 we're asking from the city is about 12% of our operating budget, anticipated estimated operating budget for the year. And then we'd be looking at asking one of our partners, Morro Bay Seniors, for an equivalent amount. So that would be asking for Morro Bay kind of composition help to be about 24% of the operating budget. So that would be about commensurate with the number of residents in this specific area. And we're excited to continue partnering with Morro Bay groups. It's been a pleasure to have our team work with some of you and partners at the Community Resource Connections Office. Julie and Sharon are here. So it's been great to work this project with them and EBAC and the Morro Bay Seniors. And so we're looking forward to working with those groups and all of you and staff and residents of Morro Bay to make this program work. Home sharing is kind of an efficient, practical use of existing housing resource. So I'm hoping we can make that case and prove some good examples of matches to bring back during this first year trial period. So appreciate your willingness to support the new operation. Even though we're new to the county, there are 60 home share organizations around the country. So it's not a new untried approach. It's been tested and proven to work. And with that, I am happy to answer any other questions that council members may have, and otherwise would just hope for unanimous support for the funding requested. Thank
okay.
you.
Okay, and thank you very much. I'm looking to my right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And we do have speaker slips on the back. Forgive me, but I will open it for public comment. Anybody would like to speak to public comment at this time, please come forward.
My name is Homer Alexander. From a presentation point of view, I believe this is the best preliminary budget the staff has ever produced. And anyone who takes the time to read the entire package should not have very many questions. I think the presentation could be strengthened even more if it included a detailed narrative on how the revenue projections were developed. In the opening letter, there is one paragraph devoted to revenue. There are 11 pages explaining expenses. As you're all aware, understanding the source and timing of revenue in public finance is very challenging. Remember, the revenue projections are half of the budget. As an example, sales tax is projected to increase 17%, which seemed excessive to me. After digging, I saw that the sales tax portion of the triple flip has been moved from the property tax line and added to the sales tax line. It would have been nice if the reason for that change was explained in a sentence or two. There are other revenue line items that reflect pretty substantial increases and a couple with decreases. Explaining the justification for those would be helpful. Several of the funds that use abbreviations and initials in the line item descriptions. For those of us that aren't familiar with government speak, it would be clearer if those were spelled out. PARS. Some general observations. I agree with the city manager's advice not to spend any excess emergency reserve funds at this time. If you exclude the fire department's mutual aid overtime from the mid-year expense adjustments and add the third quarter adjustments that you will likely approve tonight, expenses this year will be $289,000 higher than were approved in the original budget. You should wait to spend the excess reserves. As a taxpayer, I'm not too keen on transferring $60,000 from the general fund to tourism marketing. The Tourism Marketing Bureau was doing just fine without taxpayer support. According to this budget, the TBID's revenue is increasing by $56,000. In addition, since the TBID is now part of the city, it will no longer be responsible for a number of expenses that were previously funded by the assessment. Isn't that enough support? As an alternative, why not invest a portion of the $60,000 in a campaign to get the vacation rentals and RV parks included in the assessment? You could invest what is not used for the campaign in minor improvements to the Embarcadero or adding some signage to direct folks to the public restrooms. If you don't like either of those ideas, pave a few more streets. Thank you.
Thank you, Homer. Anybody else for public comment?
Good evening. My name is, we're right there at the cusp of evening. Good twilight. My name is Joan Solu. I'm a resident of Morro Bay. I'm a small business owner. I own a hotel with my husband. Thanks for taking my comment. Good work on the budget. I have to say it was probably the easiest budget that I've read in the 18 years of living here. And thanks for the presentation. I appreciate it. Susan, I'm sorry that we're going to be losing you. You did a great job here supporting this all these years with all the changes and everything that you've seen. So I really do appreciate your time. Congratulations to you and to the City Council. And I'd like to congratulate the Measure Q folks who started that program in 2008 and the residents of Morro Bay who voted that through. It's certainly breaking $1 million to the budget this year. It shows great success, and Mr. Buckingham's budget would be $1 million shorter in what we need to spend had that not taken place in 2008. So congratulations to the residents of Morro Bay. Likewise, congratulations to the hoteliers and to the team of folks that we've worked with at the city, at the chamber, at all of the events, because certainly the growth in revenue in the last 6 years to the budget, which is $1 million in growth, will break on schedule to break $3 million with $140 average ADR right now, up from $112 last year. The growth to the budget is terrific and makes staff's job and City Council's job a lot easier. A couple of things to speak to. I understand in the revenue projections for the TBID budget that the TBID is scheduled right around the 5 to 6% revenue increase. We understand the reason why Mr. Buckingham does that is so that the, and why Ms. Slayton does that is so that the budget is not so high as to not meet those revenue projections and then have spent to that level that's set at the budget and have a budget gap at the end of the year. There has been a lot of conversation about whether the TBID will continue. I will tell you that I am not protesting it, and as far as I know, the 90% of hotels that I have spoke to are not protesting it. We'd like to see Mr. Buckingham have his year and see what he can do with that. Internally, though, we are setting a revenue projection of 10 to 12% growth for you to meet this year as a partner, and we certainly hope that you can do that. We hope to be back here next year at this time and see that revenue projection met. Additionally, I'd like to say that I'd like to see a line item in your benevolence budget, and I'd like to see it be for chairs for this area. We have been sitting in these chairs for 20 years, and I think out of benevolence to the city residents who come down here interested in this meeting and many other meetings, you should place a line item to replace the chairs. Thank you.
Thank you, Joan. Anybody else for public comment?
Mr. Mayor, City Council staff, my name is Sharon O'Leary. I'm the director at the Community Resource Office here in Morro Bay. As of June 1st, we've been working for 2 years. Thank you very much for your support. It's made all the difference in the world. We continue to do an outreach commensurate with our budget. It's a small effort, but I think we're making a bit of a difference. We produce a community resource list, which has all sorts of cost savings items on it, as well as all the food programs on the back. And we go to all the food distribution programs, hand these out, and answer questions and encourage people to come into the office to sort out any kind of issues they've got going that we could help with. So it's been a great 2 years, and look forward to your continued support. Any questions at all while I'm here?
Thank you for public comment. Appreciate it, Sharon. Thank you. Anybody else for public comment? Seeing none, I'll close public comment and bring it back to council. Thank you very much for all that and great information for us and staff. And I'll look to my left to start us off on discussion and additional questions. Matt, you want to start us off? You're good. Okay. How about Christine?
Okay. So in since we have 1 hour, maybe a little less until our meeting at 6, I'm just going to kind of do my comment now, and then any questions roll into that. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. So first, a few opening remarks. I agree with public comment that we've heard from two of our speakers this evening that this is a great budget to sink your teeth into, and I would encourage everyone who hasn't yet read the budget to take a look at, it's a draft letter that's in the staff report, but at least please do read the draft budget letter. It explains essentially things that are really critical to our budgeting, which talks to you about how much we already spend on items and how much is really programmable that's even possible to spend based on our current function as a city. So please do read that budget letter, and then between now and perhaps the next budget meeting next week, we'll feel free to respond and send us more information. I'd like to thank staff for their hard work on presenting a balanced budget, each of the department heads and all of the folks who have to cut and look for ways to balance it. I know it's difficult, and I don't want you to think that we don't appreciate it or didn't recognize it. And I'm also going to speak to the public and to our employees directly with this comment. Obviously, this council, based on some of our goals you've seen over the last 2 years, 3 years, we're working really hard to make a sustainable city. So that means sustainable for our residents, those who start businesses here, and as well as our employees. We don't often talk about that, but you know, the city of Morro Bay is an employer, and we do offer good head of household jobs. And you hear a lot of conversation in the county about, hey, where are the head of household jobs? And a lot of them are in government, and including right here in our city. So out of our total employees, about quarter of you live in our city. So I guess you get a 2-for-1 in some ways. But I do want to just point out a few things about how this council is treating some of our employee issues, which we're looking forward to negotiating again in this year. And I won't be talking about negotiation, but just pointing out some things that we've been doing that do show a sustainability focus on our employees. So obviously, employees that feel valued and are fairly compensated also are motivated and provide excellent service to all of us as residents and business owners. So those two things go together. We are committed to fairly compensating folks who were working 40 hours a week but were not receiving appropriate benefits. And you can see the actions we've taken with the community development planner, bringing that on to an FTE position, taking that responsibility. And also, if we pass the two rec positions that also have been 40-hour week employees doing quite a few hours here and not being perhaps fairly compensated, we are not allowing that to continue any longer as perhaps it had in the city. Also, the city is working on economic development efforts, and we speak a lot about how that will benefit our residents by bringing in increased revenues through TOT, which you heard about, which is doing well, but also what can we do to push up the sales tax revenue. Those dollars roll right back into specific things just for us in the city, and that also includes our employees. So the city is making an effort to focus on tourism marketing, making sure that we don't lose track of a giant revenue source for us. We also are, we've created in the past year an economic development function on city staff, which we haven't had before, and that is for us to continue to focus on revenue generating, which is critical for a city that also has a lot of expenses. Other things that we've done is we've put $100,000 of general fund money into the visitor center and events. You can look at that as sales tax generating sales tax generating money. The return on investment would be that likely that we put this money into visitors and they stick around and they buy stuff and they enjoy things, and that goes into our sales tax. Also, the $60,000 in marketing we have for the first time put in tourism marketing, and I think it's a great public comment about that. And I was thinking as the comment was being spoken that perhaps we could allow our TBID to advise the city on some things that they may wish to see us spend the $60,000 in. So like get the allow the TBID board to advise council and staff on perhaps where they believe the $60,000 could be best spent. But anyhow, just wanted to make sure I focused a little bit about what we're doing on our end to increase revenue generating so that it provides great service to our city, our residents, as also is fairly compensated for our employees. It's not something that we take lightly and that we're not aware of. So wanted to make those comments. Also, I'm pleased to see the city's focus and commitment to our future with our infrastructure needs. Council gets a lot of calls and emails about the situation of our facilities, especially if they look worn out, old, broken. And the fact is we just haven't had a savings account for those things. So if you notice, the capital replacement, vehicle replacement, and capital projects accumulation funds are all funded, at least they're funded, and they will continue to grow, and we need to be mindful of allowing those to do so. At this point, I had a few questions we answered throughout the presentation. One question I'm going to ask is in regard to the contract planners that are in the budget. They're the part-time folks, the contract. They're not part-time, but they're contract. So we see them again in the budget. I'm just wondering, is that something that we want the flexibility of contract planners there? And just sort of talk about whether they would be enduring or why they're in there again in that form.
We do make use of contract planners. We have two of them. One of them will soon be leaving. She was doing our grant programs, and she's going to work in the private sector. And the other one, she's a retired annuitant, so works 960 hours for us. And that's Whitney McElvain. She's the one that's working on the last time you saw her was the secondary unit ordinance, and she'll be coming back next month to see you. We have the continued need and bulk of work to support having those planners in the budget, and I would imagine we'll have that for the foreseeable future. Certainly being contract planners, though, we have the flexibility as the workload increases or decreases to reduce those hours, and not use the full amount of salary that we have allocated towards them. So it's basically on an as needed basis, and we use them accordingly. But right now, we could actually use Whitney more. So we have lots of work, lots of programs and things that we're working on right now, and so we definitely have the need.
Two overarching comments on this. One is there is clearly a requirement for those folks this year in the community development department. So that's not something we could or should cut back on now. Perhaps it's an open question of whether there is enduring work for another full-time employee. Perhaps there is, perhaps there isn't, but there's not a requirement pushing us right now to go that direction since we have contract planners. And reminder, significant difference between a contractual person and a part-time person, that these are contract planners, and so as Scott said, their hours can vary up and down, and also there's not the same sort of fairness and equity requirement when it comes to benefits that we've been talking about with our 40-hour part-time employees.
These are really 960 is less than 20 hours a week, and the other position is about 20 hours a week that we have. That was in the grant position.
Okay, great. Yeah, I wouldn't imagine that we could reduce that in the planning department at this point with all things we have moving forward in that area. Okay, I really appreciate for the first time to pull out major citywide contracts. I think it's really important that folks see what kinds of contracts, and I'm assuming that all of these, for the most part, are reviewed annually. I know that some are, obviously, that I've been involved in, but other ones I haven't been. Are they annually reviewed so we can take a look at those? Is that yes? Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Great.
So just to be clear, if it's a three-year contract, it might not be reviewed annually, but they are reviewed before they are renewed and reviewed with a sort of a murder board of, hey, do you really need to be spending that? And is there a better way to do this? And so we're got a system in place. We need to exercise it more frequently, but in order to make sure that we're not just renewing contracts without thinking.
Right. Well, absolutely. Yeah. It's easy to do that, and it's not anyone's doing that on purpose. It's just things slide by. So I think pulling them out and having a special section is wise. I also will make then three comments and then move along. The home share support, I want to mention, and I know I'm not going to say a whole lot. I think Councilmember Smuckler will say some things too. I'll allow him to speak mostly to that. But it is something that we've worked on through EBAC and emerged from the Estero Bay Alliance for Care emerged with the idea that a home share pilot project really might work very well in Morro Bay with a lot of overhoused seniors looking to share homes with trusted roommates. And so it seems like something that we should attempt to try. Fits a lot of needs. You know, it supports seniors who want to remain independently living at home. It supports, you know, many of the matches are made with folks that just can't quite make it here on the salaries they have. Sometimes it might be a mother and a child who are moving in. Everything is going to be very clearly delineated and reference checked and things like this. That's what some of the money will go for, to do reference checks on the matches. So we're fortunate to have someone that's skilled and Ann Wyatt willing to bring it on in our community and to pilot it here. There's quite a bit of interest in it already through the seniors, our senior center also promoting it through a luncheon about 2 months ago. They had, I don't know, over 50 to 60 people attending, and we haven't heard too much negative feedback at all. Matter of fact, we're hearing a lot of encouraging feedback. The folks are very willing to try. Of course, there are more people needing the housing that are offering the housing, but if we have a few successful matches that we can share with the community, that may change. So I would fully support that, and it seems to me that getting the percentages, as we heard tonight in the public comment, would be fairly representing the amount of folks in Morro Bay that would benefit from those funds to make it legitimate for us to use those funds here in the city. And, you know, it'll be a year-long program, so we'll hear about it fairly quickly. So I would definitely support that. I also support the staff organizational changes. I don't know how much we're going to, you know, nitpick that, but I appreciate the rec reorganization. I think it's important to have one person who is very focused on our rec services. I support the finance change. I'm sure that that was influenced by the outgoing finance director, that the finance really needs to be focused on finance. There were a lot of things juggling in that department that can be elsewhere organized, especially with the focus on the legal department coming here, and HR makes a lot of sense to combine those things with the city clerk. I appreciate the willingness of a lot of our staff to expand their skills to take on new things. I also wanted to question about the revenue, why we didn't focus as much on the revenue. I think that's a great question, and wondering if maybe we could flesh that out in the second draft of the budget letter.
I'm going to add it second draft. I appreciate that. It's great feedback.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, absolutely. And then finally, that's it. So I will reserve maybe having one quick question at the end, but for now, those pretty much my comments. Yeah, if you allow me to talk again, but you can vote on it. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Christine. Matt?
Sure.
Well, looking at the budget items and the clarity, I too want to voice that work, and I want to thank you, Susan, for doing your work, and also for our Citizens Finance Committee for helping with that. The clarity, I think, the appreciation from the public will be, and from council and from staff, is going to be much appreciated. So moving ahead, this I can't wait to get this over with and then go to the next meeting. So let's do it.
All right. John?
Yeah. Thank you.
before my accolades to you all and comments, I just do have a couple of few questions, mainly for the next session that possibly we could include. First is, did you in the process do any benchmarking with either the state published cities benchmark data and or any comparative cohort cities in terms of looking at comparable costs and or revenues? And if not, maybe possibly you might want to take a look at that page just to get some assistance with what other cities on the average spend per unit. It's quite lengthy, but I think it has good data that could help. So, and maybe you have and don't need to do that. So the second one would be a question about outsourcing. Have you looked at possibilities for further outsourcing? And that would be a question for the second session. And if there aren't opportunities, that's great. But if there are possibilities that might mean lower overall costs for a service or a piece of a service, I would wonder what those might be and what those opportunities might be. Third, the investment policy on page 142. If you want to, it's sorry, it's not available to the public, and I'm not going to read the whole thing, but in essence, let me get to that page. It's dated July of 2016.
What page, John?
Oh, 142.
Okay, thanks.
In our manuals that we received.
I think that is public as well. I just wanted to make that quick comment.
Yeah, what I meant was it wasn't part of the presentation.
Oh, okay, great.
Sorry.
Thank you.
Yeah.
No, that's okay.
It is available publicly online, obviously. The question I have, given the fact that it's dated July 6, 2016, is this a new policy or is this a policy that's been in existence for some time? Yes? It does require routine reporting to the City Council, and I can't remember the last time we've had routine reporting, so maybe you could refresh my memory. It says monthly.
Thank you. The actual budget or the actual investment policy comes annually to the council with the budget, and it's done that for the last 2 years, I think this year and last year. And then the portfolio comes to the council with the quarterly budget review. So
okay, great. There's some reference to monthly, and so we may want to change that because I don't feel the need to see it monthly, but certainly appreciate the quarterly review. Secondarily, our policy is an investment strategy that is passive. I would just like to ask that we or that staff and management review in detail our current policy, investment policy, to see if there are opportunities to be a bit more aggressive with regards to possible revenues from investments. I've read it in detail, I understand it, but I would just beg the question, are there opportunities and would you review it to see if possibly there are any changes that can be made that might lend them to better returns? And I don't mean junk bonds or anything like that, or prohibited from that. So thank you for that. Regarding page 128, the wastewater treatment facility, I'm a little concerned that, and that again is page 128 in the binder, a little concerned that we as a council haven't seen routine cost reporting on this, and I can't remember, I look back, but I can't remember the last time we've had a cost report update. This is really a huge item. I think the public's very interested in it, and page 128 speaks to this coming fiscal year. Expenditures of somewhere in the area of 5 $5,946,605. And so I know that in the last WRFCAC meeting, which I was at, they also, their subcommittee has asked for routine reports, and so I would request and suggest that we get those reports so that we can be responsible for the monitoring that we're charged with doing for that as well. And then page 153, the compensation leave policy. Thank you for setting up a separate area, cost center, to be able to monitor those costs. Those costs are really huge. The compensable hours I'm speaking to for the public, the amount of sick hours that are accumulated, and the amount of vacation, floating holidays, in lieu time that folks have on the books, total $686,348.27. Two questions on that. Do we have a policy to ensure that people are taking vacation time? Because that could affect productivity, and if we don't, it would be great to develop that. And also, in general, I think look at the overall policy for use of what I call paid time off, and making sure that our accruals are not getting really, really high so that we have costs that are this high in the future. So that would just be a recommendation for the next round. And the last item, I think, with regard to questions, and then I'll make comments, Measure Q street funding. I know that there was some talk about debt financing and using the annual income to possibly expedite the possibility of achieving more. I'm not choked up over the streets, it's just this chest thing. The possibility or feasibility of achieving more of the actual street improvements faster. By doing some debt financing. And that would have to be balanced against the cost of debt, although debt's very inexpensive right now. And then the escalation point over a period of time, I'm sure, of what it would cost us on an annual basis to continue the way we're going. So I think that's something that went to the Finance Committee, and we haven't had a chance there to look at it in some detail, or maybe it came back without a full recommendation. But if we do want to move more quickly, with interest rates being low, there may be an opportunity there, and it may be well worth taking a look at. So with that, I will say the following comments. Best budget presentation in the 2 years that I've been here on the dais that I've seen, and in my years as a CEO administrator, one of the best ever that I've seen in terms of explanation of the overall finances of a very large entity, the city of Morro Bay. If you haven't had the chance, ladies and gentlemen, I would suggest that you read the didactic opening that Mr. Buckingham wrote. It is very well done. It explains strategically where we are, and it outlines a number of issues of concern. I agree with Mr. Alexander's comments about revenues, and I saw that Mr. Buckingham already has taken a note and will respond to that. We I think, as a city, really don't have a cost problem, although costs are important to look at. We have a revenue problem, and it's good to understand that. That same website, the State of California website, has a two-page document that explains revenues graphically very well. So possibly you could use that as a document to help further explain the information. Thank you, Mrs. Slayton, for your service and all of the behind-the-scenes work that you do to get all this stuff ready for Dave to look good. So I wanted to say thank you for that. I think this is a well-done budget. I think it's conservative in nature. I agree that opportunity to save some money is important with the funds that we've set up for the future. Although we're balanced, we're barely balanced. And I think, you know, I was thinking about it in the last few days as I was reviewing this. If somebody came and looked at Morro Bay as a business, and if it was a for-profit entity and asked the question, you know, should I buy this as an ongoing entity, the answer would probably would be no. And I don't say that to make comments that we're about to go under, but things are improving dramatically, but we're on the cusp with regard to revenues versus expenses, and expenses are going to increase. And unless we diversify this economy, in my mind, quickly, we are going to run into some real problems in the near future. We must obviously increase TOT. We've been challenged by Mrs. Solu with a rather large challenge for the year. But I would agree that we must be aggressive as possible with that revenue. But diversification and moving quickly to diversify this economy really, in my mind, are the answer to the issues that we're facing. Thank you all for the great work that you've done. I support what Councilman, what is your name again? Christine said, and also Matt's short comments of moving quickly. Sorry, Matt, took a little longer than you thought I should, but I'm through. Thank you very much. Thank you for a great job.
Noah.
Thank you. And I'll tell you, you don't know long. I believe 2008, 2009 was pretty much agony for everyone involved when it came to budget hearings back then. And this is quite refreshing to go through this. And I think we can attribute quite a bit of that to a process that we all have bought into and that staff has really helped us lay out that, as Mr. Buckingham mentioned, started with goal setting and working with the community to get input on buy-in on our goals and then the objectives off of that and then ultimately budgeting. So I'm anticipating this getting even better as our Citizens Finance Committee really continues to build momentum and is involved in the process even more going forward. And I'm sure that's going to help us going forward. And I think for Ms. Slayton, it's a pretty exciting way to leave the city and move on to what's going to be, I'm sure, more than just numbers on a page, which you've been so focused on for us for so long. So feel like we're on a really good track, and you should hold your head up very high about helping us get there on that. Couple of quick comments and closing on this. I wanted to echo Christine's comments about the Home Share Slow program. I think that's a really good investment. We talk quite a bit about affordable housing and always feeling somewhat frustrated about what we can achieve and what's available. And this is one of those really nice ideas of taking advantage of existing resources and just trying to be more efficient with them. And to see how quickly Ann and the team have put this together, this concept together, including the community workshop that they worked on with the seniors and bringing in experts from other programs that have been doing really well in the state, I think laid the groundwork for that. And so this is money well spent, and I'm looking forward to seeing progress there. With our Community Resource Connections Office, we had a request for approximately $5,000 in the budget. It's recommended to continue at the $1,000 level. Talking to Mr. Buckingham earlier and working with Councilmember Johnson and the CRC team, we have some more work to do there to formalize our agreement with them and the plan going forward. Council, you've supported the idea of that and our goals and objectives for this year. So in talking with Dave, I think the $1,000 kind of placeholder status quo funding is a good way to go, but recognize that we need to keep close track of this because the program is doing really amazing things, and know that as we formalize our agreement, we can look again more closely at this at mid-year as we know more details about what the future holds for the program and where they'd like to go with that. So I would be open to, if the program wanted to submit an updated request before our next budget hearing, that that would be worth looking at. But if generally, if the program feels good about that, which we can talk more offline between now and then, I'd be comfortable with going forward in that process. It's interesting to hear Mr. Alexander's comments about funding for marketing and the tourism promotions, and I tend to agree. I see that we have the healthiest marketing portfolio and fund that we've ever had when you include also the County Tourism Marketing District as well. So I'm interested to see what we can do with those funds from the general fund to help improve the overall product. And I think that was kind of part of the concept that we talked about with doing things that the tourism assessment isn't able to do. They have to be specific heads and beds, and a lot of that's focused on marketing because that's expensive. But I'm interested in the idea of asking the tourism committee to the advisory board to perhaps give us some suggestions about things. We know events are important. We're putting money there. We have talked about regional marketing in the past that is part of our economic development portfolio. So personally, I think that would be interesting to me. And I know we have committed to grow that 60,000 as tourism funds come in and our TOT goes up. So overall, that seems like a real key area to try to get better a better product, a more refined product for both locals and our guests. So I'm interested in that. I'm not sure if Mr. Buckingham, if you'd be able to coordinate that sort of a question to the advisory board or not, but I'd be interested in hearing that. We did talk about, and we probably were going to talk briefly about the prioritization of our objectives, so I'll leave those items there. I have a couple comments on that. Just want to confirm, we haven't made a decision yet about the future of vacation rental ordinance, but we're going to be talking about that later on tonight. We already talked briefly about that during the secondary unit discussion. So I'm wondering if this budget builds in some funds if we do decide to proceed to achieve a vacation rental ordinance and the cost and resources that would go into that. I'm sure we could talk more about that later on tonight and then at the future budget hearing. But that is one question that came up in my mind. And maybe I'll let Mr. Buckingham respond to that one before I close.
I've got a list of about 12 to respond to.
Okay.
Let me close up. I'd appreciate responding to a few of these now. But so maybe we should finish comments, and then it looks like we'll have 5 minutes. I can run through this list.
Good.
Yeah. That sounds good to me. I just want to close by saying how good it is to see that continued commitment to contributing to our savings and the accumulation funds and facility replacements and so forth. So that'll close it for me.
Okay, great. I'll try to be expeditious on my comments. I'll echo the compliments over this budget and compliments to Ms. Slayton for your work. And it was nicely said, you know, as you are leaving, you know, your years of service here to deliver this for the city. So that's something to be proud of. So that was great comments. You know, there's many parts of that. Let me jump into the construction that we have of this budget. I just think the part where we have this particular document that really takes our goals and objectives and puts it into the budget process, you know, it can't get any better for our community to understand what we're doing with our budget. So that's a real big highlight for me, and I think the community as we go through this budget process. Mr. Alexander's comment on PARs, I looked through the glossary, and I know this has been a work in progress, the glossary. It wasn't in the glossary. PERS is, but PARs isn't, but I'm sure, you know, it can be added. But there is a glossary in here of terms for acronyms, so I'm sure we can get that added. One thing that I think has been beneficial is also including the resolutions in here. So every particular fund here that has a particular policy, there's in the glossary in back, there's a resolution that actually identifies how we're supposed to be working on that. So that's, I think it's good. It's good information for all of us. Some of my comments on what I'd like to see going forward, the parking in lieu fund, We had in the past budget, there was a an item in there where we had $500,000 that we had to pay back. And, you know, I know that's taken care of, but I'd like to see a reconciliation in the budget. So we that was drawn on against, I'm not sure if that was the Triangle parking lot or if it was the D'Estacio's market Saltwasser property. But I know it's part of the thing that we said we were obligated to do. It'd be nice to reconcile that in the budget so everybody can see that. Also in the city manager fund, it'd be nice to see the particular funds from last year and, you know, counting how we, you know, Mr. Buckingham, how you were using that $30,000 funds there. And then one item that we discussed last year, and that was in our water fund, and that's that 1.25% debt coverage ratio that we're obligated to meet. And if we can somehow construct something in the budget that identifies that we're meeting that, and I think that came up during the part where, you know, we're supposed to be able to identify that in the budget, but, you know, we still have to work and dig into that to understand that we're meeting that debt coverage ratio. And so it'd be nice to see that in there when we come back. And let me get back to some of my other notes. There's some other resolutions that I'll send to you, Ms. Layton and Mr. Buckingham. I won't get into that. Some of my comments on that. And then there's one more. You know, just recognize, for example, I have here in my notes the internal service, IT internal service fund, as well as the capital fund and the vehicle replacement fund. There's things here. It's great to see that we are working towards the future. We've added some funds to this that we haven't had in the past. So we recognize that we are short on building up those capital funds, as an example, but we're making the first steps to do that. So in this budget, it's great to see that. And, you know, every year there's obviously an opportunity as we learn through this, you know, there might be room to massage that and add to that. You know, I'd be supportive of the shared housing program as well. And I know we can get into the list here, and which I have some comments on. I do have one for the benevolence fund request, maybe not in this first stretch, but as far as homelessness and shelters that's been discussed, this council to consider in the availability of funds at mid-budget. So there is some interest in the warming shelter, and there's some possibilities out there working with, as a member of the regional transportation advisor, the regional transportation board and SLOCOG, perhaps using a retired bus as a warming shelter. And there's, you know, whether or not those things can be put together, I just want to be prepared. Perhaps at midterm, if there's funds available to maybe assist in that. I just want to throw that out there for discussion for council. Those are the only comments I have, but great budget. And, you know, I'll stop there, and then you can go ahead and get into your comments, Mr. Buckingham, and then we can finish up. Thanks.
Great. So there's not enough time to run to Tacos Day for dinner.
Okay.
So might as well just take 10 minutes, and we'll have a good 10-minute break. Okay. A little bit of feedback on some of these things. So thank you for the positive comments from everybody, and thank you for directing those towards Susan. I'll also note that the staff over and over met in the conference room on 2 hours' notice, get in here, let's go through the budget again. So it's been a joyous time together. Thank you for that. I appreciate some of the great comments from the public. Mr. Alexander's comments about revenue are well taken, and at spelling out what some of the significant line changes are from we tried to do some of those, but I'll try to update this and do better. The great PARS debate, I just want to point out that on page XII, PARS is spelled out.
Okay.
But I'm sure there's another place where it's not. But the broader point is really important, and that is that we've taken a good stab over 2 years of getting rid of a lot of the legal or the financial speak, and we'll make sure that we try to rid this of acronyms as well, although from my military background, that's going to be a challenge. So I think we've had 10 votes for new chairs in this room over the last few months. That is not specifically in the budget this year. What is to go through a thought process. This is on our objectives, go through a thought process about Vets Hall renovation, perhaps a more broader renovation. Actually, we should ask the question of, is the Vets Hall where you want to have city council meetings for the next 20 years? Or is there another space, perhaps the community center, that's better suited for that? Could the Vets Hall be renovated to better revenue producing so people could have stage shows in here and weddings in here and or whatever? So that's a process that I think we'll go through this year. That does not mean we could not work on chairs in the meantime, though. So I've got that as a note. On benchmarking, and this goes to the revenue question, did not benchmark expenses against other cities, but the revenues are essentially benchmarked to California. We'll spell this out, but where the revenue projections came from was our 10-year budget forecast. And so as we went through, as Mr. Leyland helped us go through that, he analyzed for each of those lines, last 10 years worth of sales tax, worth of property tax, TOT, and those things, and then and benchmarked those against similar cities in order to help determine. So that's really why the revenue section is sort of light, because it says whatever the 10-year budget forecast said, we could do a better job spelling that out. We'll make sure we do that. There's actually a little bit of outsourcing in here under IT support. We talked about potentially outsourcing part of our IT. I am certainly not against outsourcing. One thing I am careful to do is to make sure that we've got great people working for the city, and I don't want to outsource unless there's a fiscal requirement to do so. I prefer not to outsource somebody out of a job. I don't think that's what anybody was suggesting, but we've got our eye on several balls of when there is personnel transition. Do we need to rehire a person to do that, or is there a better way to do that? That said, I'll say, and we might hear some of this in a few minutes, that I'll need your help, because oftentimes when we say contract in this city, lots of people get concerned about, why are we doing all these contracts? Why are we doing all these contracts? Outsourcing equals contract. And so if we indeed want to consider appropriate outsourcing, we've got to get used to saying it's okay to have appropriate contracts at certain times, which we have plenty of already. Investment policy, I think it's on the work plan for the Citizens Finance Committee already this year. If not, maybe we'll request to add that. I think it'd be a great thing for the Citizens Finance Committee to wrestle with that the questions on great ideas on that. Vacation time off policy, actually, soon after I got here, I decreed that we were going to change that, and then I realized that there's a couple of bargaining units I need to talk to, and I can't just sort of decree things like that. and I actually intended to decree it for the directors, and I didn't get around to that this year. It is on my mind, primarily from the facet that you mentioned, Mr. Heading, of which really the best thing for efficiency and the mental health of our employees. Is it best to be able to cash in 10 grand worth of vacation once a year, or is it best to take those days? I would like to find a nice balance to that, but we do have some limits right now on how much you can build up. We might be right-sized right now. I'm not sure that we are, but I definitely want to look at that. Measure Q and debt financing, I'm ready to do it. I think the business case is rock solid. and where we've come over the last year is, and this is just for all of our healthy interaction. A year ago, we said, let's consider a ballot measure for streets financing. Then we chose not to do that. And actually, the county's going to put that ballot measure on there. And then at mid-year, we said, instead of a ballot measure, let's look at a streets financing measure. We asked both the PWAB and the Finance Committee to look at that. It was a little bit tough. One of the committees wanted all the information sort of down to which streets will be paved if we pay for this. And I'm not sure that that's the best way to do this, is to make that decision based on whose street is going to get paved and whose isn't. And so then at mid-year, you actually removed that that goal from this year and said, let's do a street summit this year. I'm sorry, you did that in the goals and objectives. I think the math is pretty clear that that debt financing with some Measure Q funds is a wise thing for the city to do right now because of mobilization costs, because of the increased cost of construction over time. That said, the path we're on right now, you can change this, but the path we're on, as a council with a vote, you can change this. The path we're on right now is to do a street summit this summer. And then what we recommended is to wait until the county street tax is either passed or not passed in November and then make that financing decision, because probably even an easier decision if the county passes a streets tax and we could commit 600 grand of Measure Q to that. Enough on that now, but that's where we are. Should you want to progress with it now, I recommend that one of you identifies a council agenda item to put that back on the agenda and say let's do it sooner than later. I wrote down would I buy more obey. I agree from the ledger perspective completely, but I'll tell you that as we do opportunity more obey outreaches to local and regional influencers, educators, media folks, business people, investors. One of the bullets on one of the charts is I'm bullish on Morro Bay, and Morro Bay looks like Starbucks or Apple in the early days. I think this is a great time to invest in Morro Bay, i.e. go buy a lot downtown and redevelop it. There's great potential. I agree from a ledger perspective that $11,000 surplus is something to sneeze at. I've taken that home share slow. I'm going to, in the next budget, I'm going to write that as if you want to approve that $5,000 to home share slow. That's what I sense the council saying. Chairs and Vets Hall, we talked about. I have 2 minutes left. Community resource connections and the where we are, I think, in the process. Wonderful, wonderful service to the community. On our objectives this year is to formalize the MOU between the city and CRC, because it's sort of mushy right now. There's no real document that we can all point to that says here's what the relationship is. I recommend we do that in the first half of this year and then come back at mid-year and see if there's any budget changes that we need to do. On the $60,000 contribution to the Morro Bay or to tourism marketing promotion, what I wrote down was be very careful, quote, bait and switch. We communicated to our hotelier community that we would make that commitment as a city, and that was part of the decision to move tourism management into the city. So I think it is unwise to talk about changing that at this point, or maybe at any point. What is wise is how do we best fine tune that, and what's the and that's mostly what I heard. But I wanted to say that so our hotelier community knows that. We all recognize that was a commitment that was made related to the change in tourism decision.
And can I just note that commitment was by resolution? I think we should all be aware of that. Thanks. Appreciate that.
The answer to are there dollars in the budget for outreach and work on vacation rentals? I guess the answer is sort of, because we're going to stop doing something else if you want to do that. That's what you're going to hear in the vacation rental thing. But with the general plan, local coastal plan, and the code enforcement outreach that's going, if we add on a major vacation rental outreach now, you could find money in the budget, but you would find that by saying, let's push pause on the general plan update for 6 months, or let's push pause on something else that's ongoing for 6 months, which you can certainly do. That I'm just saying that's what you're going to hear in a few minutes. City manager funds. So we helped with the $25,000 of city manager opportunity funds. We helped with the business walk, the chamber's business walk 2 weeks ago. This is a great vignette for that. Why this is helpful. When you were approving the dog park, we were this close to approving the dog park, and we saw that there was, not the dog park, the bike park, thank you. We were this close to approving the bike park, and we said there's yellow snow fencing was part of the plan. And we were about to go back to the drawing board and figure out yellow snow fencing and how we're going to make it not ugly. And I said, we will figure out how to fix that. And so that nice wooden fence out of there, about $7,000 came out of the city manager opportunity fund in order to keep that project moving. And so really, it also lends a significant amount of flexibility. When my cell phone rang and Chuck Davidson said, does Morro Bay want to host the Amgen? Because of that, I could immediately say yes. I literally said yes right then. The good news is we didn't have to spend anything out of that in order to host the Amgen. In fact, we're probably going to, when it comes to direct and indirect costs, on direct costs, we're probably going to make a few bucks. But having that in there provides me the flexibility to be able to do some things like that that are clearly in line with council objectives, I believe. Debt coverage ratio, we definitely do to expand on that, and we will. And that's it. We have 10 minutes.
All right, great. With that, we have, we're not necessarily going to, we have these priorities that we need to discuss. We're going to come back in that at our next study session and refine that?
Yes.
Okay. With that, without any further ado, I'm looking at any closing comments. And we
I'm sorry,
adjourn.
Mr. Buckingham, did you mention the WRF accounting?
I took a note on it. I didn't mention it.
I didn't hear you address.
Yeah. I've definitely got the note. I was
thank you.
Being selective.
Okay. Okay, with that, that'll conclude this study session. We'll adjourn the meeting, and we'll look forward to our next budget study session. Thanks very much. We'll take a 10-minute break, and then we'll come back.